Today we continue with our school on modular spaces, combinatorics, and integrable systems. And today we have the third lecture by Professor Reshetikhin. Please.
All right. So I will continue with the. So I'll start with an overview of what has been done in the first two lectures. So in lecture one we discussed superintegrability. I introduced this notion and some kind of basic structure. So let me repeat again what it means. A superintegrable system, superintegrable Hamiltonian mechanical system on the phase space, which is a symplectic manifold M, consists of geometrically, it consists of two projections. One is the projection to 2n minus k dimensional Poisson manifold, and that is to k dimensional Poisson manifold but with the trivial Poisson structure. Both projections are Poisson, and connected components, and then it's so when you have such thing, connected components of the first projection are Liouville tori. Connected components of the second projection are symplectic leaves of this Poisson manifold. And algebraically, it means the following: that in the classical algebra of observables, on the algebra of functions on our space, we have a Poisson subalgebra J such that its center, I denoted it by I, has Krull dimension K. So it reflects the dimensions of these manifolds down below. So the intermediate dimension is 2n minus k. The Krull dimension of the algebra of observables is 2n, and the center should have dimension k. So the dimensions should add up. The dimension of J and the dimension of I should add up to the dimension of A. So that's the structure. The other thing is that you can think of the algebra J as the centralizer of this Poisson commutative algebra I. And the terminology is the following. These are the Poisson commuting Hamiltonians. And these are integrals. In other words, these are the functions that are preserved when you consider the Hamiltonian vector field generated by one of the functions from the subalgebra I. Okay, so that's the definition. And then the Liouville integrability corresponds to k equals n when the commutative Poisson commutative subalgebra I is maximal. So we may have two systems on the same phase space. We can have a Liouville integrable system and some superintegrable system with the dimension of Liouville tori k. And we say that the superintegrable system is a refinement of the Liouville integrable system if we have these inclusions. If the algebra of Poisson commuting Hamiltonians is, well, by definition, it is a maximal commutative subalgebra in A, but now we also require that it's a maximal commutative subalgebra in J. So now, if it is a subalgebra, it is maximal commutative. And our Hamiltonians for the superintegrable system is part of this maximal commutative subalgebra. So if this happens, then Liouville tori of the Liouville integrable system, they are fibered by Liouville tori of the superintegrable system. And that's the meaning of the refinement. So it can happen that two superintegrable systems, I mean, one superintegrable system refine the other. It happens when I say you have two systems like this, and if the integrals of one system is a subalgebra in the integrals of the other system, then the centers will be included in the opposite direction. And you have this system of subalgebras. And again, it sort of one system refines the other in the sense that Liouville tori of this system will be refined by Liouville tori of this system. So that was the first lecture. I didn't explain that one superintegrable system can refine the other, but it's kind of an obvious next step. Now, second lecture. So I constructed superintegrable systems on moduli spaces of flat connections. So first, I reminded that the moduli spaces of flat connections has a natural symplectic structure that's coming from the Hamiltonian reduction of the infinite dimensional space of connections with this natural symplectic structure with respect to the Hamiltonian action of the gauge curve. So M is symplectic when there is no boundary, and M is Poisson manifold, this moduli space, when there is a boundary for similar reasons. So then in the construction of superintegrable systems, I used the so-called chord graph functions. And this is just a brief reminder of what they are. So if you fix conjugacy classes around connected components of the boundary of sigma, then you will get symplectic leaves of this Poisson manifold. So this is an inclusion. This is symplectic. This is Poisson. So now here's the construction of the of superintegrable systems. It's a very specific construction. So you choose non-intersecting, non-self-intersecting curves, C1, CK. K can be any, it can be just one curve. So assume that they are not contractible to any of the boundary components of the connected components of the boundary. If it can be deformed into one of the boundary components, then the corresponding holonomies are constant. You fix them by the conjugacy classes. You fix them by fixing these conjugacy classes C1, Cn. So they should not be contractible to any of the connected component of the boundary. And then you have natural Poisson subalgebras that is easier to describe in terms of graph functions, and that's the reason why we have these graph functions. The intermediate Poisson subalgebra J, it's just simply span of all graph functions which do not intersect any of these contours C. And the smaller subalgebra, it's the span of all graph functions which are contractible to C. And contractible simply means that, you know, you can draw your graph in a belt that can be contracted to contour C. And the theorem that's by Artamonov and myself, that this system is superintegrable in the sense that the smaller subalgebra is the center of the bigger subalgebra and the dimensions adds up. So that's an algebraic construction. It also has a simple geometric meaning, which I mentioned, but I want to repeat it again. So it's the meaning is very simple. You take the surface and you remove this these contours C1, Ck. It means that you're cutting the surface along these contours. So when you cut the surface, open it up, like it's demonstrated here. So then you have a surface with boundary where the holonomies are not fixed. And that's a Poisson manifold for the reasons that we already discussed. So this is symplectic. We fixed conjugacy classes for each component of the boundary. And this is Poisson because for these components of the boundary, we didn't fix anything. So then the last projection is simply to the conjugacy classes of holonomies around the boundary. So these are the conjugacy classes of holonomies around boundary, around connected components of the boundary. Okay, so what are the symplectic leaves of this Poisson manifold? We already know this. You see, say here is an example when we have just one contour C. So we cut the surface along this contour C. So now in this manifold, the holonomies around these new boundary components are not fixed. But now if you fix the holonomies around the boundary components, in other words, if you fix a point in this space, so then the pre-image of this point in this intermediate Poisson manifold is a symplectic leaf, which is simply the following. It's a moduli space, but with this extra boundary components, but we fixed the holonomies around these boundary components. So this is the geometry behind these superintegrable systems. As you can see, it's elementary. So now refinement. You can choose any contour from these collections of contours, and you will see that immediately that you have the inclusion of these subalgebras. Simply by definition, this subalgebra, so these are all graph functions not intersecting for gamma, when gamma doesn't intersect Ci. Well, of course, it's a subalgebra in the algebra of all functions, Cj, j equals 1 to k. It's a subalgebra in this algebra because here we require only that these functions do not intersect this very specific Cr. So there are much more functions over here. So then, and of course, here we also have the natural inclusion. So you can see that this is exactly the refinement of one superintegrable system by the other. Okay. So you can see also that because if you just have this one new boundary component, so if you have only one contour C, then we know the rank of the center. We know how many independent functions there. In other words, we know that. Actually, I'm sorry. Here I was not correct. Okay, so here it's not the whole. It's not the Cartesian product of the space of orbits in G. It's a subspace there. So it goes over here. And now I want to describe this subspace, but I don't know how to do it. Ah, Okay. So, so we already know that I'm trying to be very creative here. So we already know that the fibers here are these moduli spaces. So naturally, we will have those conjugacy classes here for which these fibers are non-empty. So this is the description of this subset. So this is the, these are the conjugacy classes C1 prime, CK prime in G mod adjoint G, such that the moduli spaces, the moduli space MG sigma minus the union of these contours, and now we already fixed conjugacy classes C that characterize the phase space, the symplectic list, but now we also fix the this case. So we have the, we have more components of the boundary. They always come in pairs because we're cutting the surface. So here is the remaining surface, and and this is the description of B. It's a subset in this kth Cartesian power of the coset G mod G.
There is a question from the audience. I'm sorry. Yeah. There is a question from the audience in chat.
Yes.
In chat.
I didn't think about it. Maybe you can take C to be a graph. I'll have to think about it. My first reaction is that this would be unnatural. I'll show you why it might be interesting and why it's unnatural from the point of view of this discussion. So you see, the reason why these are contours, images of a circle, is because when you have a surface with non-stratified boundary, the boundary components are circles. So you can see from this mechanics, if you cut the surface along a circle, you get another surface like this, non-stratified surface. So I would say the meaningful way to cut the if you have a graph on a surface, if you cut it along a graph, that means that the result will be many pieces of stratified surfaces where you have on the boundary some marked points, the vertices of this graph. So I don't know what it means. Maybe there is something interesting there. I don't know. Didn't think about it. Maybe you should solve this problem. Okay. That's a good question. But okay, let's consider these circles. So in this, and that's basically the outline of the previous lectures, slightly enlarged. So now examples. I promised last time to have some examples, and here is the first example. Let's consider a surface with a puncture. And when I say puncture, I always mean that it's a compact surface with bound. So it's that we remove the disk and it has a boundary component. It has a boundary component. So the fundamental group of such surface is a free group generated by two elements. So the moduli space of flat connections here, or the character variety. So then another, so I just want to repeat the terminology. When you have the set of homomorphisms from pi 1 to sigma, this is the representation variety. And when you have mod G, that's the character variety. So this is the character variety. You can see that this is simply G cross G mod G. And it's a Poisson manifold. So let's fix symplectic leaf, but first let's introduce some structure. So if you choose a base point, then we can choose the, say, basis in H1, and that gives us cycles, non-generators of pi 1. So I already choose them, A and B. So there, this one. So in this green area over here, I demonstrated that the group commutator of X and Y, and X represents the A cycle, Y represents the B cycle. So this group commutator is just a holonomy around the only existing boundary component. And so if you want to have a symplectic leaf of our Poisson manifold M, we just have to fix this holonomy. And so this is the symplectic leaf. This is the phase space of our system that I'm about to construct. So Falk and Rostley were mentioned last time. So I just want to say that for the explicit analysis of this system, it's very useful to, I mean, there are two ways to make computations with these integrable systems. One is to choose this non-canonical Poisson structure by Falk and Rostley on the representation variety, on G cross G. And that's nice because it's related to standard Poisson-Li structures on G and so on. The other way is to work with quasi-Poisson structures on the representation variety. So these are the, roughly speaking, Poisson brackets, which do not satisfy the Jacobian identity. But then if you take the subspace of G invariant functions, they do satisfy the Jacobian identity. So I sort of prefer to stick with the Jacobian identities and to do computations in this fashion, but it's possible to do it in both ways. Okay, so now, so now this is our moduli space. We have a natural mapping that brings the orbit through the pair XY to the orbit through this pair. Why it's natural, we will see in a second. So then you see from here, you have two projections. The first one, if you remember the way how I explained the spin Clojure Moser system, it's very similar. So you have a projection to the first component, and projection to the second component, and they just inverse one to the other. So you have initial spaces like this. And in fact, this is just an example of what I was talking before. So this Poisson, intermediate Poisson manifold, which I explicitly described like this, this is nothing but the moduli space of flat connections on a sphere with three holes. The conjugacy class for this holonomy is fixed because we fixed this conjugacy class. But conjugacy classes of holonomies around these new components of the boundary, when we cut the surface along the contour C, and you know, I indicated this contour C on the picture, but I didn't say anything about it. So I choose it like this. So the Hamiltonians will be traces of holonomy around the contour C, so along the B circle. Okay, so just as I was explaining before, the base of this projection is the set of all conjugacy classes for which this moduli space is non-empty. The moduli space for sphere with three holes, where we put C prime here and C prime inverse here. The dimension of this Poisson manifold is the dimension of our symplectic manifold minus R, simply because in this pair, the conjugacy classes of each component of this pair are inverse. So the pre-image of a conjugacy class from B is the our moduli space, and it's a symplectic leaf in this Poisson manifold T. It's a symplectic leaf when we fix these conjugacy classes. And so you can also describe the intermediate Poisson manifold in this way. It's just a disjoint union of symplectic leaves parameterized by conjugacy classes. So we got a superintegrable system with Poisson commuting Hamiltonians, which are G invariant functions of X. So remember that C is a B cycle, and we mapped B to X. So these are the Hamiltonians. So that's a particular case. That's an example of our general construction when we have a torus with one hole and with just one hole. So now let's look at SLM. Before looking at SLM, let me mention the following. So on our surface sigma, and that's for any sigma, we have the mapping class group. So this is the space of all diffeomorphisms of sigma modulo the I think it's all orientation presuming diffeomorphisms modulo the ones that are contractible to the trivial diffeomorphism. So this is a discrete group, and for a torus this is the SL2, this is the group SL2Z, and it acts on the moduli space. And in particular, one of the elements of this group maps XY to XY inverse. So you naturally have the Hamiltonians generated by traces of XK, let's say for SLN, and by traces YK, and then if you choose some other mapping class group element, then you can map this contour C that was the B cycle to rather arbitrary contour going through the torus. So then you will have some other Hamiltonians, but all these integrable systems, they will be equivalent in the sense that they will be connected by the action of the discrete group of this answer to Z. Okay, so now let's look at SLM and let's do some specific coordinate computations. So we still have the torus with one component of the boundary. So now X and Y are in SLM. We fix the conjugacy class in SLM. And then the symplectic leaf of our superintegrable system will be just a moduli space of all flat connections on the torus with one hole, where we fix the holonomy around this hole. So now let's look at the example when the conjugacy class has rank one. So now I want to tell you in advance the disappointing news is that in this case we will get just Liouville integrable system. But it's a nice computation that shows how it works. I don't know any good, well, actually I do. We'll come to this, to another examples. So when it's the orbit of rank one, you can, so it consists of elements that conjugate to diagonal matrices where the stabilizer is SLM minus one. They can always be parameterized in this way. And another way of saying that it's a rank one orbit is that it consists of matrices with determinant one and of this form. So if we compare these two expressions, if you compute traces of these two expressions, from the first expression you get this formula for the trace, from the second you get this formula. So in particular, you can see that, I mean, that's just a parameterization of rank one orbits. So now we want to find some good coordinates on the moduli space in which the Hamiltonian looks kind of interesting. So in order to do this, let's choose X to be, let's assume that X is semi-simple, and let's choose it to be diagonal. And now let's solve this equation for whatever we can solve. So let's say, since we have nice coordinates on the rank one orbit, so let's solve this for Y. And the amazing thing for orbits of rank one is that you can actually do it. So if you write it in matrix elements and we'll take into account that X is diagonal, then you have this identity, which you can write as this equation, and you can see that it's a system of linear equations for Y. And you can start solving it, but there is some trick which simplifies the computations. So let's just consider separately two cases. First is when I is equal to J. So then you got this expression, which you can think as a form of this equation as a formula defining this, this expression. And then when I is not equal to J, you can express YIJ in terms of the same thing. So now, now we have this formula from the first equation, and then this formula from the second equation. Combining this together, we have this formula for y's, and it's meaningful when I is not equal to J in terms of the diagonal entries of the matrix Y and in terms of X, I, X, J, and phi's. So And then there is a beautiful story how to actually finish these computations and compute Poisson brackets. But I'm not going to talk about this simply because it's technical and kind of slightly gruesome computations. So instead of doing this, let's compute the Hamiltonians that are traces of Y, traces of powers of Y. So this, remember that I started with the integrable system whose Hamiltonians are traces of X, but then I said that we have this SL2Z action, so we may as well consider traces of Y. And I don't know why, but I just started to diagonalize X. And so it's natural now to consider these Hamiltonians, traces of Y. So let's consider the second one, the trace of Y squared. It's an interesting expression for two reasons. First, if you will quantize this, then these operators, they will, I mean, you have to take all traces together. This will be a system of commuting operators. So this will be McDonald operators, which appear in representation theory, and it's very interesting and important object. So in our realm of classical integrable systems, let's do something maybe strange, maybe not. Let's consider the limit when y goes to, so we have these two elements in g cross g. So let's deform y to the identity. So it sort of means that we consider the neighborhood of the identity in the second component. And the neighborhood of the identity is the Lie algebra. So it means that we degenerating our representation variety to G cross G. But remember, G is a simple Lie algebra. So by the killing form, we can naturally identify it with G cross G star. But this is nothing but trivialized cotangent bundle to G. So if we fix certain polarization, I mean, we choose one of the copies of G against the other, collapse it to the neighborhood of the identity, then we're degenerating our symplectic manifold to the our Poisson manifold to the cotangent bundle to G. And it's so then as you understand, there are non-equivalent degenerations. So as I mentioned here, it doesn't matter whether you take traces of X or traces of Y. All these systems of Poisson commuting Hamiltonians can be obtained one from the other by the SL2Z action. But if you degenerate one of them, then you cannot do it anymore. And so you have at least two non-equivalent degenerations. So let's proceed with this degeneration. Let's take trace y squared minus n divided by epsilon squared. And then it's very easy to find the limit as epsilon goes to zero of this expression, assuming that diagonal entries of y are 1 plus epsilon pi, q is 1 plus epsilon. That's the parameter describing the rank 1 conjugation orbit. And of course, in the neighborhood of the identity, it becomes the rank 1 coadjuvant orbit. And so you recognized here the Kaloger-Moser Hamiltonian. And so what we discovered is that our system that we constructed, our integrable system, which is, by the way, it's Liouville integrable system, because, you know, traces will give you n minus one Poisson commuting integrals, and it's easy to compute the dimension of the moduli space for the torus with one puncture. It's exactly 2 times n minus 1. So we have a Liouville integrable system, and in this limit, it degenerates into the well-known Kolodziej-Moser system. Actually, it's a Kolodziej-Moser Southern system. So this is why this Hamiltonian is called, well, for some reasons, somewhat obscure reasons, but it's called relativistic Kolodziej-Moser system. Well, roughly speaking, because you should think of this as e to the epsilon pi. And when you take momentum exponentiated, physicists would say that it's relativistic. So which is true, but okay, it's a name. So different degeneration gives Ruzinar's system. It doesn't matter what it is, it's a classical version of MacDonald operators. One can think of this of it in this way. So you have some kind of variety of integrable systems here. They are all Liouville integrable because we choose rank one orbit. So now, if the orbit is greater than one, well, the good news is that still, as y goes to one, it degenerates to spin Kolodziej-Moser system. If x goes to one, it degenerates into spin Ruzinar system, which I didn't explain, but it's very similar to spin Kolodziej-Moser system. The bad news is that it's difficult to find good coordinates for this system. I don't think it's impossible, but I don't think it's been done. And I think the only way how to proceed with this is to use cluster coordinates. So I think it's a nice computational problem to find a good system of cluster coordinates and to compute the Hamiltonians in terms of these cluster variables. So I think it's not done. So now another example. Let's still consider a torus, but now let's consider K holes in the torus. So the representation variety in this case, it's just you take the fundamental group and you assign group elements to each generator of the fundamental group. And these group elements should satisfy the relation in the fundamental group. So this is our pre-Poisson manifold. That's what Fock and Rosley study. They study Poisson structures over here. So this Atiyah-Bott Poisson structure, it exists over here after we take the quotient over G. Okay, so we fix the conjugacy classes of holonomies around these holes. And this gives us symplectic manifolds parameterized by these conjugacy classes. So here's the explicit description of this symplectic varieties. I keep saying that symplectic manifolds, you know, they have some mild singularities like orbifolds. So then we can play the same game as we did before. So we choose a contour C. I mean, since it's a torus with n holes, one of the natural choices is to choose this contour in between the holes along the B cycle. So, and then we have the natural projections. Now we can think geometrically. So we have natural projections of Poisson manifolds. So we have, so this is our symplectic manifold. This is our moduli space. And now when we remove this this circle, we cut the torus into a cylinder. And we still have the moduli space of flat connections on the cylinder. So we fixed conjugacy classes around these holes, but we didn't fix anything for the new holes. Except we didn't fix anything, but we only know that it's not the whole moduli space, it's a subspace in the moduli space where conjugacy classes are identified. Okay, so what can we do with this space? We can project it down to the conjugacy class on this component of the boundary, and that's the and that's this projection. So it projects to the conjugacy class around the C cycle, around the C contour. So what is the base of this projection? The base of this projection is the set of all conjugacy classes in G, such that this moduli space, the moduli space that we obtain from here, if we will assign here C and here C inverse, should be non-empty. If it's empty, then we have nothing on the base, so it's not in our base. And so this is the description of the base of this of the last projection. It's a subset. Again, it's a kind of in good cases when say we have compact Lie group and everything compact and nice, then it's a convex, not polytope, but it's some kind of convex figure in the torus of this compact Lie group G. So,
Kola?
Yeah.
Sorry, I have a question. So you don't consider the projection to the alcove, because if you consider the projection in the alcove, then probably in good cases this will be a convex polytope.
What do you mean projection?
You're saying to the torus, but the torus module, the wild group action is the alcove. And then there is that theorem of Mein, Rankin, and Woodward, which of course depends on the situation, whether that's exactly that situation, which would probably say that it's a convex polytope.
I would expect so, yes. That's why I mentioned it. But I'm not sure it has been done.
At least in some somewhat similar context, of course, I cannot immediately say whether this applies, but there is a Mein, Rankin, Woodward theorem on convexity.
Okay, so it's most likely that it works here. Thank you, Anton. So, so yes, in fact, yes, that's exactly where this orbifold singularities appear, because you have to portion by the Y group. So, because, I mean, yeah, if this BC wouldn't be a subset, if it would be the whole thing, the whole G mod G, that would more or less be, in the compact case, that would be H mod W, which has some of this, which is an orbifold. Yes, so that's the description of the superintegrable system. In this case, now the question I say, what happens when all these orbits that we fixed, what if they all rank one? It's not difficult in this case to compute the dimension of the moduli space. It is equal to 2k times n minus 1. And one can consider the system, the integrable system, the same as I was discussing in lecture 2, with contours C1, Cn, C1, CK, going just between these holes. So then it's obvious that this contours do not intersect, do not self-intersect, so this Hamiltonian Poisson commute. And in fact, we have Liouville integrability because the number of Hamiltonians is exactly of this HIM is K times N minus one. That's the number of I's and that's the number of M's. So what can we say about the relation between this Liouville integrable system and the superintegrable system that we just studied with one cycle? Well, this superintegrable system refines the Liouville integrable system. That's an example of it. And I think I didn't mention, did I mention Chalik and Feyron? No, I forgot. So this is the this is the system that was studied by Chalik and Feyron. And they constructed explicit coordinates for this system. Because it's rank one, you can use the coordinates that I described for kind of parameterization of the phase space. And then one can explicitly write Poisson brackets in these coordinates. One can explicitly write Hamiltonians in these coordinates. And one can explicitly derive Liouville integrability. And so we can see that this Liouville integrability can be defined with this superintegrability. They also discovered this. This is a general explanation of why it happens. So now for any conjugacy classes, it's difficult to find coordinate description. But again, I think with some work with cluster coordinates, it's possible. But it hasn't been done. But one can do the following. One can degenerate this system sort of bypassing to the neighborhood of the identity for variables y and m. And then this system degenerates to so-called n-spin Kalogeri-Moser system, which was studied in quantum case in our paper with Jasper Stockman. And then the classical case in the upcoming paper. And it's actually interesting that this, in the quantum case, this is some kind of, there is also generalization of this setting into some moduli spaces that generalized these cosets, double cosets. But that's a different story. I don't think I can talk about it now. So anyway, so that's what I wanted to tell now. And next time I'll talk about quantum version of this, and we will see that there is a natural kind of toy quantization of these systems that uses topological quantum field theory and. In particular, this very specific topological quantum field theory that we constructed with Turaev from representation theory of quantum groups at roots of unity. Okay, so this will be on Friday, and I think now I should stop.
Thank you, Kolya. Other questions or remarks? There is one in chat. Kolya, there is a question.
Yes, I see it. But more about cluster coordinates. It's a long, beautiful story. Vladimir Fok is going to give a series of lectures next week in this school. And also Alexander Goncharov, he is going to talk about something similar at the school in Moscow next week. So I think one should start there. And it's really long. It's a very nice story, but it's a long story that goes back to works of Fomin and Zelivinsky, cluster coordinates on double Bourdieu cells. And that goes back to Lustig's work on cluster coordinates on kind of Bourdieu decomposition of Borel subgroups. So it's impossible to say in two words.
Okay.
Okay. That's not a curiosity, that's a very good question. Can we define superintegrability when the phase space is infinite dimensional? Yes, I think there are plenty of examples of such systems. And roughly, what is the concept of superintegrability? It just means the following, that the phase space, the dynamics is such that locally, the phase space is a product of a small symplectic manifold where the dynamics is non-trivial, like in a Liouville integrable system. And in other pieces, the kind of symplectic manifold where the dynamics is completely trivial. If you can split your symplectic manifold in this way, that's a split superintegrable system. This is not an interesting system. You can forget about the trivial part. But in all these cases, this splitting is all only local. Globally, you cannot do it. So in the infinite dimensional setting, I'm sure there is such thing. So for example, if you take Poisson-Li groups and you consider the integrable systems given by characters with symplectic leaves being phase spaces, so then typically they are superintegrable, and in case when the Lie group is a loop group, then you have infinite dimensional symplectic leaves. And I'm sure there will be examples of what you're saying about infinite dimensional phase spaces and superintegrable systems on these phase spaces.